Reading in chapter 5, verse number 1. Just a little background before we get started. This is where Paul wrote to the Thessalonian church, trying to encourage them. A lot of times Thessalonians is such a small book, it gets overlooked. But it's really a church that's on fire but for the Lord, but being persecuted by the world and by the people around them. But 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse number 1. Says, but of the times and seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you. For you yourselves are know perfectly that the day of the Lord shall come as a thief in the night. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction shall come upon them, and travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But ye, brethren, are not of darkness, that day should overtake you as a thief. You are all the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. For they that sleep, sleep in the night. They that be drunken are drunken in the night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and a helmet, and for an helmet the hope of salvation. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, and whether we wake or sleep, we shall live together with him. Wherefore, comfort yourselves together and edify one another, even as also you do. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for allowing us to be here today. Lord, we thank you for your word and what it means in our lives and our hearts. Lord, we just pray that you would open it up and let us understand it and let the church understand it as you've written and presented it to us. In Jesus' name we pray. First off, in the first verse, he's telling the church in Thessalonians, I've already told you about Jesus' second coming. There's no need for me to tell you more about it. It would be nice to know what he told them, because a lot of people believe different things about the second coming. But we do know for sure that the Bible says to the unbeliever that it's going to be like a thief in the night. They're not going to be prepared. It's going to come upon them and take them, and they won't even know what's happening. But he says to us who are believers, it's not going to be like a thief in the night, because we're supposed to be looking forward to it. Looking forward to the day that Jesus comes back and takes us to be with him in heaven. But something that often gets overlooked is this about the travail upon a woman with child. There shall not be an escape. That's to the believer and the unbeliever. You know, once a woman becomes in labor, there's no way to stop the labor. It's going to continue until it's finished. And once the second coming starts, there's no way to stop the second coming. It's going to continue until it's finished. But for us that believe, it's going to be a glorious finish. The dead shall rise first, and then those of us who are alive will be called to meet Jesus in the air. But to those who are not believers, it's going to be into eternal destruction and damnation. But people don't want to hear that anymore. People don't want to hear that if they're not saved, they're going to hell. People don't want to hear what the Bible has to say, and that's one reason that there's so many churches in the shape that they are today. It's not because the people that are here don't love the Lord, it's because the people that are out there don't want to hear about it. There's a real scary statistic. You know, 3,000 churches are closing a month in the United States. If that continues in 30 years, there won't be a church in the United States. Just like Paul's encouraging the Thessalonians to hold on. That's what God wants y'all to do, is to hold on. To praise him, to live for him, to lift him up. To let him do the work. But the problem is we have to live for him. That way others can see him in us and wonder what's different about us. We don't have to beat them over the head with the Bible. That's just going to drive them away. But we have to share our love with them, share our lives with them, show them that it's not because of who we are, but because of whose we are that we can love. We don't love the sin. We don't love what they're doing. But we have to love the sinner and show them that we love them. A lot of times it's in the Bible, you see Jesus with the sinners. Jesus talking with them, praying with them, teaching them. But when he comes to the religious people, how harsh he is. The reason he's harsh with them is because they know better and still do it. But to the sinner, they don't know no better, and that's where we come in. We need to teach them better. We need to let them see that we're living for God and we're not living for the world. Verse number 4, it says, it's not going to be like a thief for the believer. Verse number 5 tells us that we're of the light and we're not of darkness. The Bible teaches we have to work while it's daylight and not dark. So there's darkness coming upon this world that the world's never seen before. And it seems to already be upon the United States. People don't want to hear the word. It's not a shortness of the preaching of the word. The Bible teaches there's a shortness of the hearing of the word. The word's still being preached, but the world's not hearing it anymore. They don't want to hear it. They don't believe it. A lot of times they don't believe it because they see us Christians living like unchristians. We're out there doing the same things that they're doing. They don't see any difference in our life. We have to be different. We have to be a peculiar people, set apart. Verse 6, 7, and 8 calls us to wake up, to clean up, and to dress up. We need to wake up to what's going on around us. We need to clean ourselves up, and we need to dress our lives up to look like a Christian, to look like Christ, to be that example, not to be that stumbling block as the Jews were in that day. They obeyed every point of the law, even to the smallest men, and given tithes to that, but they didn't obey the word of God. They obeyed the laws to make themselves look good, but in private they did all kinds of awful, evil things. And the Bible called them out for it. In verse 9 it says, the believer is not appointed to wrath, but unto salvation. And we may get wrath here in this world because of our beliefs. We may get persecuted and put down and talked about. Why do we want to worry about this flesh when it's just here for a short while and it's going to pass away and decay? What we're worried about is salvation that the Lord has set aside for us, and when he calls us to heaven, we have eternity to have peace and joy. We can have joy while we're here, but a lot of times we'll have tribulation and troubles. But one day after a while, our salvation is going to cause us to have peace forever. The Bible teaches us that there's a peace that passes all understanding. And we can have that peace now. We may have troubles and trials during that peace. It's hard to explain unless you're a Christian. You can't understand that there can be a peace when you're being persecuted. That there can be a peace when you're going through sickness. That there can be a peace when there's all kinds of awful things happening to you. But if you're saved, there can be. Verse number 10 says, whether we're alive or whether we're dead, we're all going to be together with Jesus forever if we're saved. This is what Paul was pointing out and teaching them, because some of the Thessalonians thought the second coming had already came and they missed out on it. And they thought that the ones that had already died weren't going to get to be a part of the second coming. But Paul's encouraging the Thessalonians to know that the ones that are dead and the ones that are alive, when he comes back, will all get to enjoy being a part of the second coming. And because of that, verse 11 tells us we need to build each other up, we need to comfort one another, we need to encourage one another. The world does enough tearing down. The world does enough persecuting and putting us down. It don't need to happen amongst ourselves. We need to grow and encourage, and not ignore things, but talk about it and encourage them. Show them where they're doing wrong. The Bible says to love them like a brother and many sins will be covered. We can draw them back into the fold by loving. We can't draw them back in by beating them over the head with the Bible. Just share your love for Christ with them. Share your life with them. Help them out when they need help. I know Hazel does a lot going around and different people, and a lot of you do. But the Bible says to keep it up. It says, I know you're in verse in chapter 4, he tells the Thessalonians, your love is known throughout all Macedonia. But you need to love them more. Because I know you love them, but show your love even more. God knows you love him, but we need to show it even more. And that's what we have to do, is have to continue to love the world as a whole, but not their actions, not their sins. In Romans chapter 13, verse number 11, it says, in that knowing the time now is at hand, at high time, to wake out of the sleep. And now is our salvation nearer than when we were, than when we believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envy, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provisions for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. And that right there is the biggest thing that the world has going for it, that it's pulled people away from. If the world wants you to fulfill the lust of the flesh, the world wants you to work harder, make more money, to buy a bigger house, to buy a boat, to buy a motorhome, to go out on vacation, and to not have time for God. But like I said, this flesh is just a temporary thing. It's not a sin to have money. It's not a sin to enjoy the money that you have. It's a sin to love money more than you love God and to serve your money. The Bible says that the root of all evil is the love of money, not money. You can be a rich man and love the Lord and do many good things. I can't remember the person's name, but there was a man who had millions of dollars and he gave away money constantly. He lost everything that he had. He didn't have a penny. And someone came and asked him, "Is now are you sorry that you gave all that money away?" He said, "No, I'm sorry I didn't give more of it away. Because either way, I wouldn't have any right now. We can only work with what we have in our hands right now. And that's the present. Work with what you got. We may have more later, we may have less later. But God just wants to encourage us to wake up, to clean up, and to dress up." That's really all that I have this morning. If you want to come get a song. This may be just to encourage the church. It may be that someone's here that's lost and never realized it. People go through the motions all the time and are not truly saved. God's not going to tell you that you need to be saved unless you do. Satan's the one that'll tell you, "Oh, don't worry about it. You're okay. There's nothing to worry about." If you feel that convicting spirit, if you can't go back to that day, if you just remember going through the motions and not remember actually truly asking God to save you, maybe that's the problem. And I know statistics don't mean a whole lot, but it says that only 10% of most churches are saved. That's a real scary thought. And I don't believe that to be so here in this area and in the Bible Belt, but as a whole, across the United States, on everybody that goes to church, there's only about 10% of the people who are saved. And that 10% that are saved do 90% of the work. Which means there's 10% of lost people doing work in the church.
Thank you.